coming to church and trying to be somebody that God didn't create me to be.
All right.
And when Pastor Rod asked me about doing a message, and I was already preparing to do a message for True Love, I thought about this message, Fear Factor. And Pastor Rod, when we're talking sometimes, Pastor Rod will be talking about something, and I'll come back with him with a statement, and he'll say, "Where did you get that from? You just made up something in your mind, didn't you?" I guess so. And he'll say, "Okay, you got a good imagination." So I start thinking about stuff in your mind. So this thing came from, how can you serve faithfully when you are afraid? And it came from like a mind game. And I thought about how Satan plays with your mind.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And a lot of times we come to church and try to be somebody else that people want us to be, and it's a mind thing.
That's right.
And for me, trying to be what other people wanted me to be was messing with my mind.
Yeah.
And being a pastor's wife and trying to be somebody that somebody else wanted me to be, and quote, like they say, faking the funk, you know, and it was like, you say, don't be angry. Don't say certain things. You might hurt certain people's feelings, or, you know, well, I might hurt your feelings, but I might have to say it a different way, but I'm going to say what's on my mind, because that's on my mind. But I know sometimes you have to tweak it, but I'm going to have to be me. I just can't. Maybe I just don't need to be here. You know how? Just let me be me. So I have to say, God, let me be me, or, you know, don't use me. So if you're going to use me, Lord, use me the way you want me to be used. Don't try to change me for people. Just use me. So the fear factor was, don't let me try to be what people want me to be. Lord, you use me, but don't make me try to please people. Just use me and let me say what you want me to say. But don't let me be a people pleaser.
Amen.
Let me be a God pleaser.
Amen.
And then God will do what God's going to do. And then people get in line with God.
All right.
But don't let me try to please people. Let me try to please God.
All right.
And so that's what I had to get in line with. Let me get in line with God. Don't let me get in line with people.
That's right.
Because people are... One day they'll tell you one thing, and then the next day they'll say something else.
Damn.
But I had to say, Lord, let me get in line with you. Let me get my you straight, because people will change daily. But let me get my you straight, and then I won't be crazy. Because I'm already crazy. But I'll be crazy. Yes, I am. I'm a different crazy. But I know I need to get this part right. Because I'll be, you know, all over the crazy place. Because my imagination is, because, you know, yeah, my imagination is, you know. So, this fear factor, how can you serve faithfully when you are afraid? So, I went to the mind game. Satan does play with your mind.
Amen.
So, the mind. The mind is a powerful thing. Everything that God does is spiritual.
Amen.
So you can't look at the outward. You have to look at a spiritual thing. So I went to a scripture, Luke 13, 10 and 17. And I said, every time people talk about this scripture, they always look at it physically. And it's the scripture about the woman that had the issue for 18 years. And it starts with, as he was teaching in the synagogue on the Sabbath, and behold, there was a woman with a spiritual infirmity, 18 years, and was bound together and could no in wise lift herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, Woman, thou art loosed from thy infirmities. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. Now, when I went back to verse 11, this is the King James Version, which was the first interpretation. It says, a spiritual infirmity. And I said, so I know everybody always say, you know, it was a physical thing. So why is it that it says a spiritual infirmity, though? So why couldn't it have been she was spiritually bound? Because spiritually boundness can be something that ties us down. Depression. She could have been so depressed that it had her so down. And Jesus could see that. And, you know, in today's society, people are so depressed that they commit suicide. I think about that guy that jumped off the bridge in Fulton Dale. And people, Pastor Rod knew him. And he said, man, I never would have thought that dude would have done something like that. But God can see the inward. And God could have looked at her and said, my child, why have you been bound for 18 years? And touched her and said, you loose, baby. Stand up. Whatever been holding you for 18 years, you loose. And immediately, she was free of whatever was bounding her. She could have lost a child 18 years ago. And that could have had her depressed for 18 years. Or she could have been barren for 18 years and couldn't have had a child. Or, I mean, we don't know. But we always, and then, I mean, it was different translations later that changed it to a physical thing. But the first translation was King James, and it was some translations after that that said a spiritual infirmity. So if God always looks at stuff spiritually, why did we make it a physical thing and say she was bent over? Or it was some kind of handicap that God had to heal. You know, we always say God looks at the spiritual. Why do we always have to take it to something physical? And so when I looked up infirmity, it talks about a weakness or a lack of strength. So if she's going through life with this mental issue, she could have been schizophrenic. She could have been having some kind of psychological thing that was binding her for all these years. And God said, you loosed. And then you got these Christians saying, why you heal her? Why you do that? And he telling them, because she been bound for all these years, and I'm setting her free.
All right. Mm-hmm.
And so as Christians, we got to understand that it's not when or how or you trying to do God's work. So we got to get out of the legalities of wear your Christian hat. Wear your, like we say, the legalities of doing the communion on the first Sunday, or the clothes you wear, or how you do stuff. It's just a matter of God doing his business. He trying to heal people. So the Christian saying, why you do that at that time? God is saying, I'm trying to heal people.
Right.
And you trying to hinder my work. And so, on down through the story, you hear them saying, and the rulers of the synagogue asked in a dignified way, because Jesus healed on the Sabbath day and said unto the people, there are 6 days in which man ought to work, and therefore come to be healed, and not on the Sabbath. The Lord then answered him and said, thou hypocrite, doth not each one of you on the Sabbath loose this ox? And what he's saying, y'all heal animals. And y'all don't want me to heal this soul.
All right, all right.
And that's what we do. We'll do for animals more than we'll do for a human.
All right, that's right.
And that's what Jesus is saying. Stop being so hypocritical.
Right.
Do what I ask you to do. We're looking at souls. And then I went to Galatians 5 and 6. And it says, and to whom Christ has given eternal life, don't need to worry about whether we have been circumcised or not, or whether we obey the Jewish law or not. For all we need is faith working through love. And basically what it's saying is the law doesn't matter. We're looking at the love.
Amen.
But what I also saw was, if it's saying we need faith working through love, you got to have the faith. So, how can you work the faith out if you're afraid to love?
Right.
And true love, I'm saying true love. New Covenant always talking about true love. But we are afraid to love people for real.
All
right.
Come on.
All right.
Amen. So now we're back to the fear factor. How do you get out of that fear? You've got to stop being afraid to love people. Because if faith is working through love, and faith without works is dead, and without faith it's impossible to please God. We back to the fear factor.
Back to the fear factor.
You got to love people. So you got to get out of your fear to love people. Because without faith it's impossible to please God. And unless you love the people, You're not pleasing God.
Amen.
So it's all at full circle. If you're not loving, you're not pleasing God.
Amen.
And you can't love people without the faith part.
Amen.
And you got to have the faith part. So it's that whole fear and faith. And Satan, like I said, Satan binds us with the fear. And Pastor Roy, can you get that for me? I got this illustration, and I know a lot of times we see it better through illustrations. And I had the illustration at home, and Pastor Roy, keep it on there, baby. Pull the whole tree up here. Pastor Roy scared me a couple times with my own illustration. But, you know, even when in the garden, people always, even now, people want to say that the snake was Satan. But Satan was sort of like the factor that was used. The snake part, this was not Satan.
All right, then.
You know, I had a snake for 5 years.
Yes, a big one.
Satan used the snake.
Mm-hmm.
Satan was inside the snake. So Satan can be in us. It's a internal thing.
Amen.
So that's why God is looking at the internal thing.
Mm-hmm.
people look at the snake and say, that's Satan. He was used, just like Satan can use us.
All right.
Just like God can use us.
All right.
Satan can use us.
All right.
Satan used the snake. The snake was not Satan. He was used by Satan.
All right. Okay.
This was not Satan. He can be using any of us in here.
That's right.
Satan can be sitting in here right now.
Amen.
This is not Satan. So, when I tell people, you had a snake? That's the use, that's the devil. Like Gabby used to say, the devil is a liar. This is not, it represented Satan in the Bible, but he used this. And so I had, so I had the little spider. And so my example was, so who would win the fight? If they were in a fight, who would win?
I don't know, I would be the
imagination. I got the imagination is something not actually present to the senses. To think, to believe, to fashion, to guess. Use your imagination. That's what Satan uses. He uses your mind. It's an internal thing. My imagination is, it depends on what's inside. Which one is poisonous? Because the snake could be poisonous, or the spider could be poisonous.
Depends on what's inside.
It depends on what's
that's
inside.
Right. That's right, that's good. That's good.
So with us, it depends on what's inside.
All right.
And so me and Pastor Ron was watching this, I don't know if it was a documentary or something, and they were talking about one of the football players, and then they got to talking about shoes, and they started talking about Nikes, and then they got to talking about the making of Nikes and everything, and I started looking up the name and everything. I did not know Nike meant victory. I don't know everybody who knows that. They might already knew that. Yeah. So I didn't know that Nike meant victory. And so then in the process of doing that, whoever made the Nike went on to get in the company with somebody. And in the meeting room, they were talking about coming up with a ad to campaign against Reeboks. And so they were trying to decide how to get people to buy Nike shoes versus Reebok shoes. And so they were saying that they wanted to get people to buy Nike shoes so that it wouldn't be just for playing basketball. They wanted people to buy Nike shoes to just wear with their dress clothes. And they wanted people like Michael Jordan to wear them, and famous people, so people with money could start buying them. And so that's why they start getting famous people to start wearing the shoes and advertising the shoes. And so somebody in the conference room, in the meeting room, said, just do it. Let's just do it. So that's when they came up with the slogan, just do it. And it became the famous slogan, just do it. And so I was like, okay, so there's a reason for all this. And so when you start seeing all this in sports and you see people with the shoes and different stuff, then you start, I don't know if they tell them this when they're playing or in the locker room, but it should be a mindset that these shoes mean victory. When you're going out there, you're putting this in their mind, and it should be a mindset that what you have on means victory. You going out there, you putting this in their mind that this means victory. So when I was studying, I was getting all these scriptures that is so many scriptures in the Bible that Christ is telling us, fear not, I'm with you.
Amen.
Fear not, I'm with you. Amen. Christ is not giving us a spirit of fear, but of sound mind. And then, I got all these scriptures, but then I want to give you these scriptures that is saying the one to fear, we don't fear, which is Christ. I mean, Christ is the one that if he could, he ain't got to wake us up in the morning. He could snap his fingers and all of us could just be laid out dead. But we don't fear him because we don't do what he tells us not to do. We don't do what he tells us to do. But then we fear man. We're afraid of what man might say, what man might do. But we don't fear God. We don't fear the Creator. But in Psalms 56, 3 and 4, it says, when I am afraid, I put my trust in you, in God, whose word I praise. In God I trust. I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me? Isaiah 51:7 says, hear me, you who know what is right, you people who have taken my instruction to heart, that's Christians, do not fear the reproach of mere mortals, or to terrify by your insults. Luke 12:5. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after your body has been killed, has the authority to throw you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. So these scriptures tell me that they're saying, don't fear the people who have no authority over your body, but fear the one who has authority over your soul.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
But we don't. In Romans 8:38, now this really stood out to me. This is that daddy kind of love. And it says, I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus,
amen,
our Lord.
Amen.
So, I guess for me, when you're afraid of something, like everybody was saying, don't bring it near me. When you're afraid of something, you're going to stay away from it. So, don't fear Christ in a fearful way where you stay away from him. But fear him in a reverence way where you put him on a pedestal. But reverence him where you know who he is, what he stands for. But reverence him in such a way that I remember we were watching this mother-daughter thing on TV, and she was saying, I reverence my mom in such a way that I would never rebel against her. Mm-hmm. But she was telling me about her rules, and she was saying, now, you are becoming a teenager. You getting ready to have these hormones, and I will not have you cuss me out and do all these ruly things that some of these kids do. And she said, now, I really didn't know what she was talking about. But then when I started going to school and I saw some of this other stuff these kids was doing, and I said, oh, that must have been what my mama was talking about. But I never would have done some of that to my mom because I respect her too much. That's the kind of reverence we should have for God.
Amen.
We respect him too much to do that.
Yeah.
It's like I would never do that to God. Do we? Do we respect him enough?
Wow. Good question.
Do we reverence him that much that we would say, I would never do that to God?
Wow.
I would never rebel against God. But the opposite of reverence is rebel.
I wonder.
So, if it's anything in his word that he's told us to do and we don't do it, we're rebelling.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
So, the fear factor is love him enough. Just love him enough to do what he says do.
Amen.
And just have that relationship that I don't care what man says. Lord, I just want to have that relationship with you. And regardless of what man says, I just love you enough.
All right.
That I'm going to just do what you tell me to do.
All right. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Fear factor.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, say the fear factor.
Fear factor.
Amen.
Thank God for Michaela giving us a word and a picture of the serpent. And she said something that I just want to reiterate as she gave us a word that Satan was in the serpent. What made him dangerous was what he had in him. God was in Jesus.
Yeah.
What made him powerful?
All right.
Was what he had in him.
Amen.
Jesus' spirit was in Paul.
Yeah.
What made him powerful?
Okay.
Was what was in him. Listen at this. When Judas got ready to betray Jesus, the Bible said Satan entered. I really need us to get this right here. He walked with Jesus for all Jesus' 3 years of ministry. He saw everything that he done. He saw incredible ministries and healings and deliverance and people being fed and somebody who had years of being lame returned to walk. He saw all of this. And then he allowed Satan to enter. Why am I bringing that up? Because there's some things that all of us sometimes we'll say, you know, I'll never do that. Come on, have you ever said that? I'll never do that. But can I tell you this? If you allow Satan to enter, you betray Jesus. You betray your families. You betray your finances. You betray any kind of relationship there is. Why? Because Satan entered. So how do you keep him from entering? Where Jesus is. Come on now.
All right.
Where Jesus is,
amen,
Satan can't take abode in. He can't live there. Greater is he that's in me than he, who is the he, Satan, that's in this world. If you allow him to live in you, you won't have to worry about it again. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Fear factor.